Good morning and good to see all of you. That is, good morning here where I'm at. Good evening where you're at. Welcome to this colloquium series, and it's good to be connected to you. I'm currently 12 hours off and at a different time zone, currently on a little vacation visiting family in the United States. But this is too important to be something that I wanted to miss, so I'm glad to join you as we reflect on what we have introduced quite a while back, a new book that we're going to explore today in our book session. Before we dive into this book, I want to invite you to not just be Zoom or Facebook watchers as we live stream this. If you are in one of those other platforms, this is a discussion format, and it's going to get very boring if I'm the only one talking. So I hope that you can join me here and join the Zoom link. So if you are joining us via Facebook or Zoom, just write a comment on the side. Our Carol, who is hosting and organizing all the background to this, will assist you in joining the actual Zoom link so that we can have a conversation. With that, I want to introduce the book that we're talking about in this colloquium series. And this colloquium series, again, is a series that wants to engage more deeply into the material. So I invite your comments and all of your engagement into this deeper study of this book. The book that we have, that we selected and announced to you about 2 or 3 months ago, is another huge book. In our previous book discussion, we looked at Augustine's City of God. Now we are exploring this book, Echoes of Scriptures in the Gospels by Richard Hayes. Richard Hayes has written quite a number of works, particularly in Baylor Press. Previously, he's published a book on Reading Backwards, where he already deals with some of the material, but he's also written one of the books that is most highly considered, a New Testament book on ethics, New Testament ethics, and it is considered one of the 100 most influential books of the 20th century. So he has written some very important works. And here we have another big book to discuss, Echoes of Scripture in the Gospels. As you can see, this is a 500-page book that he has written. And I think it serves us well to just understand a bit of the background. This was a fascinating part of reading this book myself, his introduction. By the way, introductions are an incredibly important part, or the preface often, of a book, because it allows you to see the glimpse of an author, what he's thinking and how he has engaged with the material himself. Often it gives a context to why is the author addressing this issue? What is the concern of the author? What problem is he trying to solve? Or it gives some personal background. The author wants to thank this group of people that helped him prepare this because of this reason. Sometimes it illustrates that this book came because of a lecture series. And so that is the context out of which it arrives. So prefaces are an instrumental and key part. It's very easy and very tempting to sometimes just flip over those opening pages and say, I can save myself reading those 10 pages. I find sometimes these opening 10 pages to be some of the most important parts of the book. In fact, here I also think for this book that it's really important to know the setting of the book that we're discussing today, Echoes of Scripture in the Gospels. This book is, Richard Hayes in the introduction explains some of the personal background that prompted him to write this. He notes that he had started writing the idea of this many, many years before the publication of it. But then he got involved in administrative work at his university, at Duke University. He became the dean of the Department of Theology, Religion and Theology. So he was engaged with the administrative task. And he admits that for 5 years, he was not able to work on research at all, which to me is a fascinating thing because I can resonate in part with that, that administrative tasks, and maybe students don't always realize that, are very demanding in terms of their time and resource. And here's an author who said, I had written, I'd gotten sabbaticals, and I had this manuscript, but it just wasn't publishable. And then I got this administrative task and I was set back by several years and it just languished. And then he notes that he received the diagnosis of pancreatic cancer and he only has weeks that the doctors are giving him to either for his body to respond to very aggressive medication and hopefully surgery is possible, or that he will have to face death. And in light of that, he said, I had to first put my personal things in order, and then I had this manuscript. And here, friends and family came together and said, you need to publish this manuscript. And so the publisher and others got together, and he shares how a group of people helped him put this book together in an incredibly short amount of time. Some of his former students and colleagues and friends and the publisher themselves put this book on an expedited track, and he was able to publish it. So that's what we have. In some ways, this is kind of a culminating work for Richard Hayes because it is such a large volume and because he had put many, many years of thought into this. This is a book that took about roughly 10 years in the making. So this is a huge book. And in fact, some of the books that he had published earlier, he references and says, well, they're actually things that came out of the manuscript. They might have been published first, but they're actually books that that came out of the notes of this manuscript. So even though they were published earlier, they're actually later works in his thinking. Only then does he come back and revisits and makes this a whole picture. So that is a bit of the historical background of this book. And I think it is important to understand how seminal this is for Richard Hayes and how instrumental. There are other books that are easier to and shorter to read. He has written quite a bit in articles and journal articles on Pauline studies. Here, he deals with Echoes of Scripture in the Gospels, a new territory in some ways for him. And yet, here he kind of brings together his methodological approach and gives an example of how it would look like put into practice in a more comprehensive way than some of his other works that he's written. That is a little of the historical background that is helpful to know as we dive into the discussion of this book. With that, now that we've kind of set the stage for all of this, I do want to, and we look to the content of the book and how it affects us and what we can learn from it. I invite you to just pause for just a moment as we tune ourselves into a moment of prayer and consider and reflect on this book. So I invite you to, knowing this background now of this seminal book, let's have a word of prayer as we look at the content. Dear Lord, I want to thank you this morning or evening or whatever time it is around the globe. I want to thank you for the opportunity to discuss and reflect on what scholars have considered and looked at in their research of Scripture, and how that affects us, and how we can learn from these ideas of great researchers and scholars. I want to thank you for this book and the time that we have to reflect on it. Please be with us in these moments of reflection, we ask in your name. Amen. So, with that, we can now dive into our questions and the pattern of discussion that we have engaged with before. What I usually like to start off is kind of start around the perimeter and focus gradually on the main corpus or the main importance of this book. And that is looking at the style of writing. This book is an interesting book because it has an introductory chapter and then four major sections, one for each of the Gospels, and then a final conclusion chapter in which some of the ideas are summarized and brought together full circle. This already is an interesting dynamic. In some ways, that opening chapter is an introduction to what Richard Hayes calls figural reading of Scripture, or reading backwards. He uses these two terms, and I think he means the same thing with these two terms. And he reflects on that in that opening chapter. And then he has a chapter for each of the Gospels in which he gives a demonstration, a background to this. And then finally, there's a conclusion chapter. The most controversial part might actually be that it's four chapters of examples: Mark, Matthew, Luke, and John. Now you would say, why is that controversial? He actually makes an interesting point in defending this, the argument being John is usually not included when we talk about, when scholars discuss the Gospels. Not that it is not a Gospel, but that it is a Gospel that is very different in style. It is a lot more theological, a lot more symbolical than the other Gospels. It is, most scholars would argue, written much later than the other Gospels, more concerned with Christology, possibly, and written towards a community, already much more focused into this community idea. Rather than dealing with the material in some ways, it already envisions and looks forward to how does it affect the community. This makes John a very unique approach. And of course, if you have ever read the Gospel of John, you notice that it is very different in style than the previous three. And so these are usually referred to as the Synoptic Gospels, and John has its unique focus. Richard Hayes had the opportunity to, as he had completed or largely completed Mark, Matthew, and Luke, the synoptic sections, to just close the book. And now he's facing this pancreatic cancer and almost near death. And he has the option just to finish the book and close it with a reflection on the synoptic gospels that are close to each other. And he says, I would rather wait, and I would rather not have this book published than leave out John. And in fact, for John, he recounts that he only had a rudimentary outline. And one of his students, doctoral students and professor at this point herself, she contributed largely to the writing of this book. Why is that significant? Because Richard Hayes makes a point that he says this book, the Gospel of John, needs to be read in the same context as the Synoptic Gospels. It shouldn't be treated as so different. And he argues that we might have expanded and put more emphasis than is necessary into this idea of the difference of these of this gospel. And he argues that it also deals, much like the others, with Christology and intertextuality and these issues that he's trying to confront. And so he argues it was important for me to include all four gospels and treat them equally. And that is an interesting observation right off the bat for this work. So that those four chapters, as we noted, are in some ways quite important to Richard Hayes, that he would even delay the publishing of the book just to be sure to include the Gospel of John. That brings us to our first set of questions. So now we have kind of the layout of the book, a very straightforward layout. Each chapter then is divided into several questions. And in the questions for each chapter, he wants to answer some basic questions. And these questions, I'll just pull it up so that I am faithful to the questions themselves. He says there are three major questions that he wants to address in each of the chapters, as he, just before, in the concluding paragraphs before chapter one, he will say, we will be asking how each evangelist carries forward and re-narrates the story of Israel. So how is the story of Israel represented by the authors? Number two, we will listen carefully to the ways in which each evangelist draws on scriptural stories and images to interpret the world-changing significance of Jesus. So the story of Israel, the story of Jesus, and finally, the story of the church. How does this impact, and how do the evangelists shape the story of the church? So these are the three questions that guide each of the chapters. That in itself is interesting, because if we discuss and look at the style of this book, he sets out with very clear parameters, and they're the same for each of the chapters. In our opening questions that we always like to start with, starting kind of at the perimeter, we have questions such as, what style of writing does the author use? How would you describe the author's style of writing? Or what can we learn from the writings of this book for our own research and writing? And how does the structure of the book add or distract from the topic? If we look at that whole group of style questions, there are some interesting observations maybe to make right at the beginning. And that is, Richard Hayes' style in some ways is very clear. There are these three questions, and there are the four chapters for the four gospels, and there's an introduction and a summary. As you explore this, there is a very clear sense of, you know, where the book is going. He's made it very clear. And that makes it helpful as reader to follow, especially in a book that is 500 pages long. So in that sense, I encourage, as you write your dissertation, or as you write your chapters for a thesis or a paper, set out with a very clear goal of what you want to do and allow the reader to follow along. And reflecting on my own writing, maybe I've not always been clear enough in this style of writing. How can we be clear to the reader? Sometimes I've, in discussions with students as well, heard, well, the reader just didn't catch what I was trying to say. Well, help the reader as an author. How can we implement some of the good things the author has been doing? Be sure to, if the author is, if the reader isn't following well, then as an author, make sure that you guide the student, that you guide the reader. Make sure that it more fully incorporates. For readers, it's sometimes hard to see where are the lines and where's the trajectory that you're trying to go as an author. And if you set out clear goals, it's easy to follow and it's easy to come back. As you noticed, it just took me a second to find that section in which he clearly outlines what he wants to do in each chapter. So that I found to be very, very helpful in Richard Hayes' document. There are some things that I wish would have been a little clearer in the chapters themselves. These ideas continue to be resurfaced, but it starts to intertwine in the chapters. In the chapters themselves, there is no more this clear distinction. There are some, but it kind of weaves in and out of these ideas. Generally, there are these three big subsections in each chapter: the story of Israel, Christological concerns, and ecclesiological concerns. But they blend and they weave. And that is partially due to the material that you're dealing with. It is very difficult to talk about the story of Israel without engaging with the God of Israel. And when you talk about the God of Israel, you're so close to Christological concerns or the story of Jesus in the Gospels. So Christological and Israel, the story of Israel, concerns weave in and out of each other. And that sometimes makes it harder to follow. Is this now a Christological thing or is this an Israel thing? One place where that might be particularly interesting, and actually the Mark brings these things together, is the story of the fig tree. The parable of and Jesus's cursing of the fig tree, there are two elements that weave together. There is a depiction of Israel, the nation of Israel, or the people of Israel that have are no longer producing fruit. And yet it also speaks about the harvester and Jesus as a character who is enacting judgment. And so judgment on the people also means judgment by, and now we see how these two things already merge together. And Richard Hayes tries to bring out both points, recognizing though that in this section, he's actually only supposed to be dealing with Israel. The same is true for the parable of the tenants, where the tenants are not following God's plan, and then they at the end kill the son of the owner of the vineyard. It's an indictment. It's a judgment on the religious leaders. So this is should be dealt with in the section of the story of Israel. But at the same time, it already deals with Jesus as the son of the master of the vineyard, the Son of God. So these two things in the Markan story already blend, and that makes it a lot more difficult for Richard Hayes to keep these in separate sections, and impossible in a way even. That adds to the complexity of the book, because you're dealing with the original material, which blends, and yet you're in a 500-page book. You're trying to deal with one topic at a time. And for that, just reminding the reader of it, that section is one thing that Richard Hayes tries to do all the time, to remind the reader, this is the major thing that I'm exploring and looking at the moment. So that is a little to the structure and style. I wish, and the complexity of the material that he's trying to deal with. In terms of style, there is one thing that I wasn't quite sure about, or a stylistic feature, and I know this is sometimes something a publisher also has some input on, and that is footnotes. Footnote versus endnotes. Generally, in more popular writing, endnotes are preferred. Many people that engage with material don't want to engage with all the footnotes, and they just prefer to have, if I want to look at something, I want to refer to the endnotes. I personally love the idea of footnotes, because immediately as I'm reading a text, I get to see the document that the author is referring to. Now, if I can show you a page here, this book is focused on endnotes. It does not have footnotes. So if I can show you a page here, those of you that have read it yourself, you know this, but those of you that haven't, here's a sample page from the document, and you can see there are no footnotes. Instead, at the very end, the book has, that's the bibliography. Let me find the page here, going backwards and trying to figure it on a screen. Here you can kind of see notes on pages, and then it's not quite in focus, but you can get the idea. Here are the endnotes. And that makes it a little harder to engage with the material. I would love to know, here's a footnote, have quick access. Oh, he's referencing this book. He's referencing this author. And some of that gets lost. So if we talk about style things, I prefer endnotes. And that's something for you to consider as you write your dissertation or your thesis. You will have to use footnotes. But as you write material later on, think about who are you, what is the audience you're trying to address. If you're addressing a popular audience, then endnotes is the preferred way. You keep the distractive elements out of the main text. But if you want to engage people more into thinking and push them to, you know, engage with this author, here's an idea that I gleaned from another author, then footnotes are very helpful, because you can actually reference very quickly footnote and comment. So I find that a lot nicer. And I actually really like the SBL style versus APA style, for example, because you get a complete, you get a discussion in a footnote very often. You get a specific page number. And that's one of the best places as students to also find additional material. So some students sometimes say, well, how do I find material on this topic? And the best thing is to just start reading a book and follow the trail of the footnotes. So you see an author engaging with this person, pick up that book. And if you look at that book, then you'll find the author is referencing another book. And suddenly you're going from one book. It's like breadcrumbs that you're following, and you can see how authors engage with one another. So I love footnotes, and I suggest that you think about how to use it. Coming back to this book, it's a 500-page book, and it includes a lot of passages and texts for which you have to know quite a bit of background. It is in an academic publisher, Baylor University Press published this book. this is academic work. And so I'm a bit surprised that they chose to use endnotes in this, and I wish they would have preferred and gone with footnotes instead. I find it a lot more engaging and pleasurable to read and see where an author draws his inspiration from, especially this book. And the reason why I say especially this book is because Richard Hayes presents a contribution methodologically. He argues for a figural reading of scripture, or the reading backwards. And this is a contribution more on the side of methodology. How do we read scripture? The individual passages that he is now connecting intertextually are not that unique. Most authors have recognized them. For example, he opens in Mark very astutely and correctly with the intertextual opening, the mixture of Isaiah, Malachi, and Exodus in the opening lines of Mark. But this is a concept that is well known among scholars, and every commentary will comment on this. Every good commentary will note this particular conflation of passages. What is unique is not that Richard Hayes recognizes it, it's what he does with it. And so that is the methodological point. And here it would have been very interesting to see how he engages with other authors. The text itself only makes casual reference to other authors. It's primarily Richard Hayes's interpretation. And then in the footnotes, he has further discussion and points where he agrees or disagrees, sometimes also very long comments. But that's why it would be so much more interesting, because the body of the work doesn't engage that much with other authors. In his introduction, he does make some connections to people, but more in an exemplary fashion. He cites, for example, Obama's inauguration speech as an example of figural reading. He also cites Martin Luther as an example, but in a methodological work, you don't want to just look to or give examples. You want to substantiate your perspective. And certainly, he has a very interesting and dynamic approach to that. That's why I just think footnotes would have helped the style of the book. That was a discussion on the stylistic passages and some of the things that are working really well, and some of the things that I wish the book would have included to give it a clearer picture. As I'm discussing and reviewing with you this book, let's move on from the stylistic questions, kind of the perimeter, kind of warming up, to some of the key points of the book. And so in our next section, what are the key points of the books? What is the line of argumentation of the author? What is his main point? Well, I've already alluded what I think is the main aspect and contribution of this book. It is a more comprehensive approach than some of his other works, like the book Reading Backwards, where he deals with, first of all, Pauline, understanding of intertextuality, and some of his other works. And he supports the idea, and he contributes by making a methodological argument. That is his, I think, major contribution, a new perspective on how we should read and how we should understand the use of the Old Testament as a background to the New Testament. And that is fascinating. Intertextuality is a rather complex study. I think sometimes it is taken for granted. And we don't give enough attention and care to intertextuality and the complexity of the argument that it includes. Starting in the 1950s, semiotics became a mainstream study. And semiotics deals with how in general, we as human beings deal with signs and what signs mean. For example, a flag of a country, the flag of the United States, the flag of Philippines, the flag of Kenya or any other country, is actually just a piece of cloth, sometimes cotton, sometimes polyester, sometimes big, sometimes small. The important part is not the material. It is that it stands for something. People say this flag gives identity, it gives meaning, it represents something. If from an American context, people would say it represents democracy, it represents freedom and liberty, because those are values that are enshrined in the ideology of the people. If you would ask French people, they would say it's fraternité, brotherhood. They have meaning. This little garment or this cloth has meaning to people beyond the actual colors or the shape or the form. And that is what semiotics is talking about, symbolism and what it does and what it means and how it acts and how people react to it. And by extension, language is also semiotics. When I say a word, there's a certain association that you have with that. It represents something. If I say blue, you will say, well, blue represents a color, and this is what the color looks like in general. Now, we might have different understandings, actually. The parameters, there's a general idea that we would all agree upon. This is blue, for example, the sky or water. But you quickly realize, is water green? Well, sometimes it is. Is water purple? Yes, sometimes it is. Is water black? Yes, it sometimes can be. And that already shows you that even this reference to just a color has different meanings to different people. How big is the spectrum? And you will probably recognize discussions that you might have had. Is this pair of trousers black or is it dark, dark blue? Is this blue or is this green? Well, that already signifies that there are some commonalities to signs and some differences that we perceive. And the same is true. So that is the study of semiotics. And with that, I just want to introduce the complexity of it. What is shared in terms of meaning and what is different in terms of understanding of a sign? Another example would be, let's say, a stop sign. A stop sign is just a piece of metal, but it represents something. It gives meaning to something. It means you have to stop at a certain line, at a certain place. Now, what that exactly means, sometimes it means slow down. Sometimes it means you have to completely stop. That depends on the local context, maybe, or the situation. And your association with that might be positive. It might be negative. It might be neutral. This is just something I have to follow, or I'm annoyed at this, or this is for my safeguarding. That depends on a lot of context. That is the study of semiotics. I suggest, first of all, that this is something that you study very carefully as you work on theses and dissertations, because intertextuality is always one author referencing works that ring in the ears of the audience. And that, in some sense, has to do with semiotics at some level. And Richard Hayes is aware of that. He doesn't get into the full discussion of that, but that is his point. He argues that the audience, this is his assumption, that the audience of the early Gospels, of all the Gospels, was deeply steeped in Semitic thought. That is one of his presuppositions that he points out. The Old Testament scriptures, he argues, yes, there is some Greco-Roman background as well, but the Gospels were deeply enshrined in the Holy Scriptures for the Jews. And so we must understand the writings also as coming out of this sacred material. But that is allusions and references that ring. Those are signs that are pointing when an author uses this. What is he doing and how does he do that? And this is Richard Hayes' major contribution. How should we read the Old Testament? And he struggles and he argues against a historical critical view that says there's a warping, a false interpretation of the Old Testament scriptures. And he instead argues if we carefully read the Old Testament and listen to it, well, then these things become meaningful. And the gospel writers actually are very intentional in their use. So that is the major contribution. In fact, he wants to go beyond just, if I could summarize what I think he's trying to do, Richard Hayes argues that there needs to be a theological reading, meaning not just a, here is a allusion. In fact, he divides into three, a quotation, an allusion, and an echo. Quotation is the strongest. Allusion is fairly strong, but not explicit. And then an echo is faint. Connection between two passages, between the New Testament, the Gospel passage, and the Old Testament. That by itself is an interesting division, because some authors have argued for a much more diverse, much more a nuanced reading. I find this a lot more helpful than what I've read from some other authors. By dividing it into six or seven or eight different categories, or limiting it just to one or two, I think Richard Hayes strikes this perfect balance of recognizing the major differences, but not going into way too much detail that is often not as helpful to distinguish. So I've appreciated his take on this. But recognizing this nuance now, Richard Hayes' contribution is we need to not just read the individual passage or the individual words and try to find an answer to, is this right or not? But how does this add to the understanding of the author? How does the larger context of the Old Testament passage? And that is something fascinating that he does in terms of coming back to style in his book. So if I can just point out another passage here, just to show how he does this, he actually prints out here, and on both pages, you can see this, large sections of Old Testament works. Rather than just citing and saying, well, this refers to Isaiah 6, read it in your own time, he actually prints it out, and then usually he even italicizes the passage that he wants the author, the reader, to focus on. And that is incredibly helpful because it allows you to see the large scope that he's trying to do. He's not just looking at a few words. He's looking at a large section, a chapter, or multiple verses. And then in the passage, he'll actually expand, often including the chapter before and the chapter after. That's what I mean with theological. He doesn't just look at the direct reference, but the context into which from which it is grabbed and into which it is written in the New Testament. See the big picture. Another author that I've seen that, first of all, is often connected to Richard Hayes is N.T. Wright, and an author that also argues along the same lines, namely that we need to read Scripture more globally, not just focus on one verse and what does that mean, but try to understand what is the background, what is the argument, what is the author trying to do, how is he moving the reader along. I remember a discussion at the Society of Biblical Literature in which it was actually not Society of Biblical Literature, but the Evangelical Theological Society, in which there was a disagreement between various authors on Romans, and N.T. Wright said, "You're all misunderstanding the big point. What is Paul arguing in the chapter before and in the chapter afterwards? And that will help us solve what this chapter is about." And I think that is an interesting approach, and one that Richard Hayes also does, both for the Old Testament as well as for the New Testament. This becomes very, very much theological. Now, Richard Hayes would not say that there aren't literary parallels. In fact, he tries to point them out. These words are the same, or these words are similar. For example, he'll argue euangelion, the noun good news in Mark, does not exist in the Old Testament, but the verb to proclaim good news, euangelizo, that does appear in the Septuagint. And so he connects the words here. Other places he'll say, look, this is the only phrase in the Old Testament where you have these words. And look, here you have it in the New Testament. The author in the New Testament can only be referring to this passage in the Old Testament. He makes the literary connection, the words. There are words that match. So that is important to Richard Hayes. But at the same time, he says, look at the big picture in the Old Testament and in the New Testament. What are the authors trying to do? And we must keep that in context. And that is an interesting contribution. It combines some of the ideas that N.T. Wright has done in his own way in a historical sense. Richard Hayes does not go into historical, he stays into intertextuality. But it is that that junction of a narrative reading of Scripture, of a literary, of an intertextual, of a historical, and even though he doesn't argue for a social, it does say you have to understand the context of the passages. And that is an interesting contribution. It's at that intersection of these disciplines that Richard Hayes is writing this book. So what is the contribution? I think that is the contribution. Again, the passages have often been referred to by many authors. What Richard Hayes now does, he looks at the same passages that commentaries explore, but he takes a bigger perspective and he looks at a lot more context in the Old Testament and the New Testament perspective, and therefore develops a line of thought. How does this contribute to the reading of Jesus Christ? Or how does this help the church? Well, look at the bigger context. That, I think, is the large contribution. So if we think about how does this book add, what are the key points, I find that this is the main point of the book. This, at the same time, puts me into the point of a critique. This is an excellent book and has incredibly valuable aspects. But as I was reading this contribution that he's making, and this important contribution could, in my opinion, be enforced. The difficulty of this book, and here comes part of the critique, this is usually the next step, but I also I want to move a transition from a description of the book and its value and its key points to a critique. The critique of this is that this is not a methodological book, even though the main contribution is a methodology, in my opinion. And in fact, the opening chapter, the introduction, will make a large point of this, and the summary again will argue this. The introduction chapter and the summary chapter that deal with this are fairly short and brief and don't engage much with different authors, as I've noted before, in the main body of the text. In that sense, it is not a methodological discussion. The major focus of the pages, for example, the Gospel of Mark has about 100 pages of material just on the Gospel of Mark, and equal portions approximately to Matthew, Luke, and John. While the introduction has about 15 pages, something like that. And yet I would say those 15 pages are some of the juiciest because it makes this methodological argument. In this methodological argument, I wish there would have been more detail. And I think this is the complexity of what he's trying to do. Again, if this is the intersection, as I sense it is, between reading the narrative, the story, how it develops, how a chapter before and a chapter after presents, for example, Jesus, or how the Old Testament has a chapter before that deals with, let's say, judgment, and a chapter after the passage that deals with restoration. If that, and that is part of his argument, if that is the case, how do you determine that? How do you methodologically find that? And he's not very clear. It's fairly vague. And maybe that is the complexity of the methodology itself, that there is a certain vagueness. In fact, in the summary, he has an interesting statement that he makes, in the conclusion, an interesting heading in which he, I'm just pulling this up on the conversion of the imagination on page 360 of this book. The conversion of the imagination, there's a certain level that he recognizes has to do with listening attentively, being led by the Holy Spirit into this reading, understanding and converting our imagination to listen to these echoes, because they're very often not explicit. How do you do that methodologically? I would love to have a more detailed study of, well, this or that are boundaries or parameters, watch out for this or watch out for that. He makes a passionate plea for this figurative reading or this reading backwards, but it lacks concreteness. There's no, here are five steps that you should do, or these are the 10 steps to avoid, or here are the problems that you should be addressing. None of that is there. And I wish in this book that as a major contribution has this methodological contribution, I wish there would have been a lot more on, well, how exactly do you do it? Or what other authors have followed this path? Or how do you engage with people that are like-minded or opponents? He does mention a few, even personal discussions with detractors or people that he disagrees with, and that is helpful. But there's only one or two that he mentions. And that would be a lot more interesting to engage more methodologically. I wish the major part of the book being exemplary, let me demonstrate how to do it. So the book is an example of this approach, but the actual method or the dangers or the presuppositions are fairly brief. And I wish it would have been divided up a little differently, or I wish there would have been more methodological section. Also partially out of self-interest, because I find his approach so close and so appealing personally. And actually the reading of this book was by recommendation of a good friend and colleague, who said, you know, you need to read this book. So that's why we put it on the list of influential books to read. And I love what he does with the text. I love how he deals with intertextuality. I just wish there was more of methodological nuance or definition or concreteness. At the same time, I recognize that we find ourselves at this intersection where it might be difficult to actually have a 10-step approach or a 5-step or whatever, because it is that engagement of different disciplines and a more global perspective, one that is a lot more art than it is science, that is more led by the Holy Spirit to reflect and listen to the theme of the Old Testament. How do you prevent subjectivity, though, in this? And that is a big question that is kind of left off. And maybe I can point you to an example where I find this particularly interesting. And I'm just looking for the page itself. On page 49, Richard Hayes actually makes an interesting argument. He says in Mark chapter 6, verse 34, the passage in the context dealing with the issue of shepherd, like sheep without a shepherd, that is the passage. You might remember that background. Jesus, seeing the hungry crowd, had compassion for them because they were like sheep without a shepherd. And he puts that into the context of the Christological contribution that Mark is doing, Jesus as a figure of David. But he makes this interesting point that the echo of this passage in Mark 6:34, and I'm quoting, might suggest a Moses-Joshua typology, which would depict Jesus as Moses' successor. This reading is apparently confirmed by the event that follows, a miraculous feeding of a multitude in the wilderness, Mark 6, 35 to 44. So in the next verse, we have more of this apparently Moses typology. But then he goes and says, on the whole, however, Mark does not develop a sustained picture of Jesus as a new Moses. And with that, he turns away from this Moses imagery and turns back into the David imagery. This is about David. And he argues that this passage is actually stronger in its connection to David. And that leads exactly to this question where he makes this argument. Well, it could be a Moses typology. There's actually arguments in the passage. You could even see that, but I'm not going to read it that way. I'm going to read it as a David imagery. Could it be both? What are the subjective boundaries? Is it, would somebody else be correct in reading it as a Moses typology? Is this one or the other? Is it both? How much subjectivity comes into this element of this listening to the allusions of it? And that is where I wish the methodological section, kind of wrapping up this critique, would have been stronger in pointing out some of these dimensions. And how can we safeguard ourselves from the subjectivity while recognizing, yes, we do need to listen to the echoes, and the Holy Spirit does lead us into a deeper understanding of scripture, and there is an art element to this process. In fact, this is his big argument. When people speak, the allusion that, or the example that he uses of the Obama speech is, Obama, in his inaugural speech, made allusions to Martin Luther King, and he uses that, but also changes it, gives a new dimension to it. And I think he is right on the money. It's a very interesting argument that he's making. He's not trying to make a political statement, just showing that even in political language or in everyday language, we make allusions to ideas and concepts. So this is not so out of the ordinary. It's just that we need to refine it and listen to it. So that is his argument. But how can we prevent subjectivity from coming into that? Or what would be the appropriate way? And I wish there would have been some more concrete evidence, recognizing at the same time that this is a very vague field, because it is at the intersection of multiple disciplines, intertextuality, biblical theology. So the argument that I shared with the Moses and Joshua typology, that is a biblical theology statement, arguing that the theology of Mark does not have a major focus on Moses and Joshua. Well, that's a big picture, a biblical theological argument to rule out a certain reading. So it comes at that intersection, or to include something in other places. It comes at that intersection of biblical theology and exegesis, of narrative, this is how Mark or Matthew or Luke are writing the story, or even intertextuality, the Old Testament, not just narrative there, but exegesis as well. So it comes at this intersection, and that makes it so unique and interesting, because it gives more prevalence to some of the forgotten disciplines, such as biblical theology. If you have taken a theology class and read Garrett Hazel's influential book on New Testament as well as Old Testament theology, he makes the argument that we have basically given up on biblical theology due to the complexity of the topic. Well, here it's coming back, and that's a wonderful contribution, an important contribution. But how do we guide and set parameters, and how can we replicate this? And that, I think, would be a wonderful contribution to elaborate on that more. As we continue our reflection, or as you listen to me reflecting on this book, what are the presuppositions that the author makes, explicit and implicit? Or what arguments does the author leave out? Well, I've already addressed some of the things that I wish would have come out more in terms of the methodological section. One of the presuppositions I think that is not addressed, and that I wish would have been addressed a little more, is, well, putting it another way, Richard Hayes actually says he's not going to engage with it at the beginning. It's not that he isn't aware of the issue. He just says he will not deal with the issue. And that is the presupposition of how much did the original audience understand of these allusions. Using the example of Mark, or maybe Luke more than maybe John and Matthew, it seems that the Markan audience is more of a Roman audience. There's many things they don't understand that Mark needs to explain. For example, Aramaic or other elements. Every time there is a reference to an Aramaic saying, Mark will include the actual original words, which is interesting by itself, but then he'll give a translation. So for example, when Jesus raises Jairus' daughter, he says, and Mark recounts this, tabita cum, but then he translates this in a what we call a narrative aside, a little side comment. Google Translate, or actually Mark translated, this means, little child, arise. Okay, so he translates it. That clearly shows that he didn't expect his audience to understand Aramaic, otherwise that would have been superfluous. It wouldn't have been necessary. So his audience is not an audience in Palestine, whether Roman or not, because they probably would have understood the language, even if it was a Roman centurion that had lived for 10, 15 years in Palestine, they would have picked up on these basic words. But his audience doesn't understand that. How much do they understand of the Hebrew scriptures? How well are they acquainted with the intricacies of the arguments Mark is then making if we say there are all these allusions, and we need to listen carefully to the echoes from the Septuagint? Well, that presupposes that the people that read this had a deep understanding and an intricate knowledge of the Septuagint, of the words in the Septuagint, probably having memorized them to some extent, having heard these and now hearing some of these things, at least some, maybe not all, but at least some of these connections. And that is an interesting presupposition, because that is hotly debated. Were people literate? Were they illiterate? What is the makeup of the audience in a church? And I want to be hesitant. I think this is where social science comes into the picture, and we sometimes have images of people, of ancient people, just being ignorant, and we are very sophisticated. It makes us look good. That might not always be the case. Ancient people might have been very sophisticated as well. We might have more knowledge about atoms that they did not have, but that does not mean that they were ignorant to all matters of life. But this is an interesting question, and he makes the presupposition, I would argue, without explicitly stating it, that they must have had a very profound insight into scripture, at least some or the majority of the audience, for them to pick up the nuances of this. And that is an interesting statement that I need to research and explore more myself, because it is hotly debated how well people were acquainted with the Old Testament, who the audience is, are they aware of the scriptures, do they just have a superficial understanding of Jewish customs and rituals, or do they have an intricate understanding? And if they do, of what parts? So that is an interesting aspect that I find that is a presupposition, and that deserves more contemplation. It might work in collaboration with Richard Bauckham's seminal studies that argue for a more universal gospel, one that isn't limited to a single community. And maybe this is where we need to shift our thinking. Very often, commentaries and older works say there's a very specific community, and we can extract who they are by reading the book and trying to extract small information. Maybe Gospels were written on a much larger scale, as Richard Bauckham's argument. They were written for the whole community. If that is the case, maybe there's a bigger argument to be made that Mark didn't just think of Roman converts or Greek converts, but was thinking of even Palestinian converts, even people in Israel. So that is an interesting presupposition that I think this method has, and that needs to be explored further, where social studies can now hopefully help us find social studies and narrative studies better answers to some of these things. In my dissertation, I argued, for example, that people must have had a profound understanding of Moses and Isaiah because Mark references these as authoritative figures. He doesn't explain those, but he does explain Aramaic. So they must have had some understanding of the Old Testament, his audience, that they would say, well, that's a good argument. He's citing Moses, that Jesus citing Moses, that is credible. So they must have understood scripture and understood the importance of Moses for the argument to work. But to what extent would you listen to the nuances of individual words and links to Isaiah and Jeremiah and Ezekiel and Zephaniah as Hayes is arguing? And it also leads to another presupposition. Is it only audience focused? Should writings only be read in light of the audience focus, or is there a larger picture? In music, let's say, did Beethoven just write for Ludwig van Beethoven? Did he write his symphonies for the people to understand, or did he just write because he felt that's what music should be? And whether they like it or not, whether they understand it or not, he didn't care. There's an argument to be made on both sides of this argument. And so that's an interesting intersection point of presuppositions. So that's something to consider in this book. Coming to the synthesis, what points do you agree with? What did you learn from this book? What passages challenged your thinking? I think maybe here I'll just summarize some of the points that I've already appreciated and said that I really like. I really like his bigger picture idea, and I think it's easy to just focus, and sometimes it's necessary for the scope of a dissertation or work to just focus on a passage, on a verse, or a short pericope. But here we're looking at big picture approach, and that is a valuable contribution, and I really appreciated that, and I agree with that. His introduction has profound insights. I enjoyed how he cites Dietrich Bonhoeffer and Luther to substantiate some of his ideas, arguing that these are ideas that he's building upon, not that he is inventing himself. And I think those are interesting readings that I wouldn't have initially thought of for Bonhoeffer and Luther. So I've learned to appreciate those authors as well, as they already point into this direction that Hayes is now expanding on. I've also, in particular instances, particularly in the Gospel of Mark, I have appreciated a bigger view and a new understanding of some of the passages, allusions that he is bringing out that I was not aware of in that context, especially the deep connections of Isaiah and Jeremiah to Mark. I think he really has a contribution as he's adding these elements to that. I think there is actually, coming back to the short passage about Moses, I think there's an argument to be made of more of a Moses approach. So this is where I think we might be able to add to what he's begun and add a new dimension to that. And there's also a few places where I'd say I didn't read the passage quite that way, but in general, I've really appreciated his focus on including this prophetic voice of Isaiah, Ezekiel, Jeremiah. Daniel, of course, especially in our community, we've always already included this picture of Daniel in our reading. He has that as well. We might disagree on some of those small nuances, but in general, he has this interesting perspective. But I have personally learned to appreciate more of the passages of Isaiah and especially the Isaniac hope of a restored world. And I think that's the point that he's bringing out. Yes, there is judgment, but now Jesus focuses not just on judgment on the nation, though that is an important factor, but also restoration. And that's the contribution Jesus makes. So I find that to be an incredible element, the restorative nature, and that is actually not something new with the Gospels. It is a surprising element that people didn't expect, but it is something that is already found in Scripture. And Mark now proves Jesus is building on the restorative element. Redemption is already prefigured in the Old Testament, and Jesus is enacting that. So I found that argument to be very convincing, and I appreciated that a lot. These are some of the key aspects that I found in this book that have contributed to my understanding, and I have enjoyed reading this book. If you haven't had the chance to read it, I highly recommend this book. This is a very engaging and helpful book that everyone should be reading and needs to engage with, that works in any level of intertextuality or the Gospels. This is a must read, I believe. And even if you're working in Pauline studies, Richard Hayes' smaller work is also a must read on the Pauline echoes, in which he deals a lot more with specific Pauline passages, but the ideas, the methodological approach is the same. And so if you're in Pauline studies, you might need to juggle between these two books here, the more comprehensive approach, and then the book itself. I know this has been, this is my reflection on the book. I hope that was enlightening to you. In something like an hour, you get the 500 pages compressed, at least in an overview fashion, maybe not all the details. But this is a wonderful book to have and to read. I have enjoyed, I have actually made, and it was a bit of a sacrifice, and Carol knows this because Carol, I asked her to scan a couple of articles that I couldn't take along in my carry-on for this trip. But I did say, this is a book that is worth hauling around the world, literally, because I want to read this in my own copy and make comments and engage with it deeply. And this is definitely a book that is worth that. And I hope you will pick it up and learn and engage with it as well. Fascinating book, much more to be learned from as I reflect on this for my own studies. And I hope that you will find that engaging as well. I want to thank you for joining and listening. I also want to invite you, coming up next month, we have a lectureship. Dr. Ricardo Gonzalez, our dean, will be doing a colloquium session for us. And so I invite you to come back next month. You remember that our colloquium always consists of three aspects. There's faculty lectures, internal lectures, and that is coming up next month. And then we have our lectures that are book reviews. This was this week. And then we also have the external interviews. So that will be coming up as well. And we'll announce that as we come along. Thank you so much for joining me for this adventure into reading Richard Hayes' Echoes of Scripture in the Gospels. Thank you for listening to me. I hope you found this engaging and learned something out of it. Continue to read, continue to engage with scholars and learn new approaches. I hope this is a blessing to your work, to your ministry, and to your spiritual life as well. Thank you for joining me. Let's close with a word of prayer, and then we'll be on our way. Dear Lord, I want to thank you for scholarship that we can build on and learn from. I want to thank you for the work of Richard Hayes that has introduced new concepts and new approaches, brought together different disciplines into a new and better understanding of intertextuality, the Old Testament, as it impacts the reading of the New Testament. As we engage with this and learn for our own devotional and personal life, but also for academic pursuits, I ask that you be with us, and we thank you for the scriptures that are so multifaceted that we can always learn something new. Be with us as we depart. We ask this in your name. Amen. Thank you so much, and see you again next month.